Let's try that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to see you this morning. We're going to start off the service this morning by standing and singing Joy to the World.
And heaven and nature sing.
Savior reigns. Let men the songs employ. Of fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat it. Repeat the sounding joy. No more the sins and songs. Amen. Please have a seat.
Good morning. First, I need to remind you to bring in Christmas cards that you want to send to people in the congregation. There is a basket down on the front table in the gathering area that you can drop them in, and the youth will sort them alphabetically, and then you can pick them up the next time you're here. So, this is really funny because several years ago, I mentioned that we had done some things with the chrismons and should I do them again? And of course I was told, yes, start Sunday. So, and then this morning someone came and was asking me about them. So we're going to be each Sunday between now and Christmas explaining the chrismons again on the tree. Chrismons originated, the best they can tell, at the Ascension Lutheran Church in Danville, Virginia in 1957, and they've been adopted by churches of many denominations to be used at Christmas to remind us of God's Son. The word chrismon is derived from Christian monogram, and they're religious symbols representing many aspects of the Christian faith. They are done in white and gold because the white is the liturgical color for Christmas and Easter that signifies joy and holiness, and gold represents the glory and majesty and kingship of Jesus. The pictures that you will see are all chrismons that are on our tree. And the first one today is the lamb. The lamb is the symbol of Jesus. In John 1:29, John the Baptist announced Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And in 1 Peter 1:18 and 19, it tells us, "For we know that it is not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious lamb, precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect." The next one is the anchor cross. The anchor cross was used by early Christians as a symbol of their faith when they had to avoid recognition as Christians to avoid persecution. It also reminds us that Jesus is the anchor of our faith. Hebrews 6:19 says, "We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure." Next is, I think, the crown. The crown symbolizes the kingship of Christ and his victory over sin and death. Jesus gave up his kingly crown to dwell among us and wear a crown of thorns. The crown of thorns that the Roman soldiers placed on Jesus was a parody of a crown of flowers that they wore during festivals. Hebrews 2:9 tells us that, "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone." And last today is the triumphant cross. This cross represents the earth with a cross on top. Kings and queens would carry orbs at their coronation, symbolizing authority. So this symbolizes Christ's dominion over the world and that Jesus is triumphant over everything we face. Psalm 21:7-1 says, "The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom shall I be afraid?" And we will do some more next week. Thank you.
Thank you, Debbie, and good morning and welcome to Emmanuel Baptist on this second Sunday of Advent, December 8th. We're glad you're here with us. All of y'all watching out there on the live stream, we're glad you're with us as well. And if you're watching this recording a couple years from now, in the middle of summer, we welcome you as well. Hope you're Christmas in July. Sounds like a good one. Everybody put it on your calendars. Watch this one in July. All right. So that said, I will be brief in announcements because we got a very full Advent Sunday. I don't know. I'm quite proud of y'all, Emmanuel Baptist. It seems like any time of the year I can say we got a lot going on. So it's great. So today we got a lot going on. So announcements are simply this. We have board meetings this week. Just because it's December doesn't mean we can take these off. Both the Board of Shepherds is meeting and the Finance Committee is meeting on Tuesday. And new members of either of these committees to plan on attending these this week. That said, we are going to light the second Advent candle. So I'll go ahead and invite the Sayer family up.
Last Sunday, we considered the hope Jesus' first Advent brought to our world. His Advent was God setting into motion his plan from before the beginning of time to save mankind. Jesus, God the Son, stepped into humanity's history to bring about God's plan of salvation for all mankind. He came to bring hope and peace between God and humanity.
The season of Advent allows us to step into God's perfect peace and enjoy his abiding presence. Our Lord spoke to his disciples, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you," John 14:27. The Apostle Paul echoes Jesus' message when he writes, "The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus."
Our world and many times our lives experience an absence of peace. We long for it and may even strive to attain it. In the season of Advent, we can discover that God's peace is not something we attain, but a gift we receive as we pause and rest in God's presence.
May we experience God's perfect peace he has promised to us, peace that will not disappoint, peace that is beyond anything the world can offer, peace that calms the depths of our souls and breathes new life into our weary lives, God's peace.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we bow in prayer before you today to ask that you help us. We ask that you send your peace into our lives. May your peace flow into our lives, and then through our lives, may it influence our communities as we seek to serve you. May we yield to your Holy Spirit as we walk in daily peace provided by you. We praise you and worship you this day as our sovereign Lord and Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Wonderful job. Thank you, Sayer family. Today's call to worship will be Psalms 128. How blessed is everyone who fears Yahweh, who walks in his ways. When you shall eat of the fruit of the labor of your hands, how blessed will you be, and how well will it be for you. Your wife shall be like a fruitful vine in the innermost parts of your house, your children like olive plants all around your table. Behold, for thus shall the man be blessed who fears Yahweh. May Yahweh bless you from Zion, that you may see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. Indeed, may you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're humbled and grateful to come before you in this Advent season, this most wonderful time of year that you have provided for your people. We pray continually for your blessings upon our church. We pray continually for guidance as we move into a new year, Father. We ask you, Father, for opportunities to glorify you and to just show your grace through the world around us. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to have a slight change in the music. I believe the bulletin says we're going to do How Great Our Joy. Instead, we're going to sing the first Noel. If you are using a hymnal, it's page 136. We'll be singing verses 1, 2, 3, and 6. So let's stand as we sing. Traditions of our church, an old tradition, is the white gift. Mark Miller is going to come now and lead us in the story of the white gift and explain the tradition.
For many, many years, Emmanuel Baptist has a tradition of taking the white gift. The white gift is based on a Middle East legend, and it is about a king. It says, the story goes like this. A great many years ago, in a land far away from us, there was a certain king who was dearly loved by all his people. Many admired him because he was strong and just. In all his dealings, they knew they could depend on him. Every matter that came to his consideration was carefully weighed in his mind, and his decisions were always wise and just. Women trusted him because he was pure and true, with lofty thoughts and high ambitions, and the children loved him because of his gentleness and tenderness toward them. He was never so burdened with the affairs of state that he could not stop to speak a pleasant word of greeting even to the tiniest child, and the very poorest of his subjects knew that they could count upon his interest in them. This deep-seated love and reverence for their king made the people of this country wish very much for a way in which they could give expression to it so that he would understand their love. Many consultations were held in meetings, and one after another the plans were suggested and considered and rejected. But at last a happy solution was found. It was rapidly circulated throughout the kingdom, and it met with the most hearty approval everywhere. It was a plan to celebrate the king's birthday. Of course, this had been done in many lands before, but there were certain features that the celebration would differ materially from anything that had been tried before. They decided that on the king's birthday, the people should all bring him gifts, but they wanted in some way to let him know that these gifts were the expression of love on the part of the giver, which was pure and true and unselfish. And in order to show that, it was decided that each gift would be a white gift. The king heard about this beautiful plan, and it touched his heart in the most wonderful way. He decided that he would do his part to carry out the idea and let his loving subjects know how much he appreciated the thoughtfulness. You can just imagine the excitement in the kingdom as all over the land, as the king's birthday drew near and people made their plans. All sorts of loving sacrifices were made, and everyone was anxious to make the gift the very best he had to offer. At last the day dawned, and eagerly people were dressed in white, and carrying their white gifts, they came to the king's palace. To their surprise, they were ushered into a great big room, the largest in the palace. They stood in silence when they first entered it, for it was beautiful beyond all expression. It was a white room. The floors were white marble. The ceilings looked like a mass of soft white clouds. The walls were hung with beautiful white silken draperies, and all the furnishings were white. In one end of the room stood a stately white throne, and seated upon it was their beloved ruler, and he was clad in shining robes of white, and his attendants, all dressed in white as well, were grouped around him. Then came the presentations of the gifts. What a wealth of them there was, and how different they were in value. In those days, it was just as it is now, there were many people who had great wealth, and they brought gifts which were generous in proportion to their wealth. One brought a handful of pearls, another a number of carved ivories. There were splendid laces and silks and embroideries, all in pure white, and even splendid white chargers were brought to His Majesty. But many of the people were poor. Some were very poor, and their gifts were quite different from those that I've been telling you about. Some of the women brought handfuls of white rice. Some of the boys brought their favorite white dove. And one little girl, smilingly, gave him a single white rose. It was wonderful to watch the king as each one came and kneeled before him as he presented his gift. He never seemed to notice whether the gift was great or small. He regarded not one gift above another so long as they were all white. Never had the king been so happy as he was that day, and never had such real joy filled the hearts of his people. They decided to use the same plan every year, and so it came to pass that year after year on the king's birthday, the people came from here and there and everywhere and brought their white gift. The gifts which showed that their love was pure, strong, true, and without stain. And year after year, the king sat in his white robes on the white throne in the great white room, and it was always the same. He regarded not one gift above another, so long as they were all white. So here at Emmanuel, we use the idea of a white gift to do as Christ reminded us, to give to those who are less fortunate than us during the Advent season. So our white gifts are non-perishable food items that will be used to help others in our community who are struggling, and those families that are connected to our church that we know have a need. So as we sing our next hymn, which is Hark the Herald Angels Sing, if you haven't already brought forward your white gift, please bring it forward during the song, the hymn, and place it in the boxes here in front of the communion table. You can also put it in the box or put it in the offering plate with a note, okay? Thank you.
Let's stand and sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, 3, and then we're going to repeat verse 1 again.
Gracious, giving Heavenly Father, we thank you for how richly and abundantly you have blessed each and every one of us. We thank you for the blessings you poured upon this congregation, and we pray that you bless that which we send back out, whether it's through our white gift or whether through its tithes and offerings, and you use that to bring glory to yourself and draw souls ever closer to Christ Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
in Bethlehem, a baby born to save the souls of man.
Good morning. I want to just begin again with an expression of thanksgiving as my mom's funeral was yesterday. Many people came and visited with us. I know many more wanted to and could not make the trip, and I understand and am very appreciative of your prayers, your love, your support, your encouragement. Thank you so very much. Today, as we continue in our Advent celebration, we move to the concept of Christ bringing us peace. And the peace that he brings to us gives us a deep joy. And we want to look at one who experienced that joy in the presence of his King. So if you are able to stand, I invite you to stand as we read just two verses from the Luke account, Luke chapter 1, verses 44 and 45. As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her. May the Lord add a blessing to his reading today. Join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, we thank you first and foremost for this season. A season of time for us to pause, to slow down, to rest. Lord, to just marvel, to consider, to reflect upon all that you have done. Lord Jesus, you truly are Emmanuel, God with us. And you have brought us love, peace, joy, and hope. Today, Lord, I pray that you would just help our minds to be focused upon you as we consider these words that Luke provides us. Lord, I pray that our minds would not race ahead to events that we think will happen today or tomorrow or the days to come, and equally not to be caught into the yesterdays of life, but for this moment, may our eyes be focused on you, our risen King. Lord, I ask that you take these very simple words I prepared, and allow them to be a means by which you speak your very message to our hearts this day. I ask in your precious and holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, as we looked at last week, you had in Luke, you have Zachariah and Elizabeth who get a word from God. You had Gabriel come and visit Zachariah in the holy place of the temple and to announce to him that God had heard his prayers. Wouldn't you love that when you're praying tomorrow morning for God to show up with his angel and say, your prayers have been heard? Well, you know what? You don't need the angel to come tell you that because he hears your prayers every time you utter them. But Zachariah, in that moment, hears those words from God that he and Elizabeth, in their old age, okay, way beyond normal, would have a child. And that child would be the one who would make ready the way for the Messiah. Well, you know, that wasn't the only visit Gabriel made. It's about 6 months later from that event, and Gabriel shows up again, but not in Judea, not in Jerusalem, not in the temple holy place, but somewhere in the village of Nazareth up north in Galilee. Nazareth didn't have the best of reputations, okay? Wouldn't necessarily see where you think God would show up, but God sends Gabriel there because there's a young maiden. Her name is Mary. She is a virgin. And his message is to her that she will have a baby. And not in the normal way. The Holy Spirit will come upon her. She will be with child. She will go 9 months and she'll give birth to this son. And he will be Emmanuel. He will be Yeshua. He will be Messiah. You will name him Jesus. And you remember what she said? How? Okay, not a doubt, but just how can this happen? I'm betrothed, but I've never been with a man. How could I get pregnant? And the angel said, it'll take place. And her final words are, may I be the Lord's servant. May your words come true. God, may your will be done in and through me. Isn't that exciting? And as she makes that commitment to this call that God has placed in her life, a call that takes her totally out of her comfort zone, would take us out of our comfort zone, would put her in danger of public humiliation and possibly execution. Do you realize that? This was serious business. If Joseph wanted to press the matter, he could have her stoned. But she says to the angel of the Lord, God's will be done. And the affirmation, he says, well, by the way, as you are surrendering to this plan God has for you, I've got another word. And the word is, your cousin Elizabeth. And see, she knew Elizabeth, not, you know, they didn't like us. We get together all the time. It was a 3-4 day walk to get from Galilee down to the Judean hillside where Zachariah and Elizabeth lived. But she knew Elizabeth. And she knew that Elizabeth and Zachariah their whole life loved kids and wanted to have a child and were not blessed with the child. It was the only black mark on their lives. They lived a life that was just above reproach, except they never had a child. And Mary knew that. And she knew how Elizabeth yearned to have a child. And the angel says, and by the way, Elizabeth, she's 6 months pregnant. Okay? What would your reaction be if the angel told you this person in your life that's 75 years old is 6 months pregnant? See, it puts a little context to it. But see, she already said, may the Lord's will be done. I am the Lord's servant. She surrendered to what God wanted to do. And so the angel says, you get a little window of confirmation. Elizabeth is in her 6 months. And what would you do at that point? It's just what Mary did. She went to her parents and asked if she could make a journey down to Judea to the hill country to visit Elizabeth and Zachariah. And of course they're overwhelmed with that. And they've got to make arrangements. They have to find someone who's making the journey or hire someone to take her because she couldn't journey that on her own. It would be inappropriate. It would not be safe. It would not be the way things are done. And so it would be probably a week getting everything lined up for her to begin the journey. And then it would take close to a week, 4 days, to walk from Nazareth all the way down to the hill country outside of Jerusalem in Judea where Zechariah and Elizabeth lived. It's going to be about 2 weeks. And for 2 weeks, Mary has in her mind what God has said to her through the angel Gabriel, the assurance that she holds in her heart that whatever God says is true. But boy, there's just this little bit of hope that when she sees Elizabeth, she'll be pregnant. And she makes the journey. And that Luke passage that we picked up there in chapter 1 today, is she comes to the house. She comes and she makes that trip and she journeys there. And her hope the whole trip is that when she walks in, she'll see Elizabeth and Elizabeth will be with child. Okay? I mean, it's the hope. Because if that's true, then everything's true. Not that she was doubting what God could do, but boy, it's kind of hard to trust God when it's beyond what we think's possible, right? Has God ever told you he's going to do something in your life that you don't think is possible? Has he? I hope he has. I hope he stretched you. Whether it's an activity or an event or a calling that he's placed upon you that you've engaged and you see at the other side that, man, God made that possible. Well, she journeys there, and when she gets there, she looks for Elizabeth. She comes to the door. She knocks and comes in, and she calls out Elizabeth's name. Elizabeth has hidden herself for the 5-6 months of pregnancy. You know, kind of hard to explain. What's going on here? What's happening? Is this really real? But at that point, Mary comes. And she sees Elizabeth. Can you imagine? She walks in, and Elizabeth comes from the back of the house out to where Mary's at. And when she walks out, it's there. She is with child. It's just what Gabriel said. That which was impossible has occurred. Zechariah and Elizabeth in their old age, because remember Zechariah said, I am too old. And my wife is what? He didn't say too old. He said well along in years. Okay? He was a wise guy. All right? They all knew it. It's impossible. And yet in that moment, she sees what the angel had said, which just further confirmed and enhanced and grew the faith she held on to that she herself would be with child. But you know, it's not just that she would be with child. Because what does Elizabeth say? What does she say there? How am I so blessed? How am I so blessed that the one who carries Messiah would come to my house? Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you bear. See, it's not that Mary's going to get pregnant. She is. She's not showing. She's only a couple weeks. But Elizabeth confirms for her that within her womb, that child has already begun to develop, is already growing, is already alive. Wow. Just like God said would be. And Elizabeth is just like, how great and wonderful that I should be blessed and favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me. That's verse 43. And then she says, and as soon, just as soon as I heard your voice cry out to me, this baby in my womb started doing calisthenics. He's jumping all around. Why? Because his role is to what? We heard it last week. He is to what? Announce and prepare the way. He's in the presence of his king. He's in the presence of his Lord. He's in the presence of his Messiah. Even in the womb of Elizabeth, John is leaping for joy and announcing that this one in Mary's womb that no one even detects yet, even she herself may not have detected it yet, is the Messiah. He's the Son of God. He is Emmanuel who's come to be with us. Isn't that exciting? John's leaping for joy. He's celebrating. He's having a party because Jesus has come. Jesus is here. The nation has prayed for over 400 years, and now it's happening. The Messiah is here. Messiah has come. And John can't wait to get out and learn to speak, to say, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Go follow him." He's leaping for joy. He's excited. He is jumping and celebrating that baby Jesus is right there. Right there. Right there in his presence. You know what? Jesus is in our presence. That's his promise. I'll never leave you or forsake you. Jesus is right here, right now, with us. He was with you when you arose this morning. He'll be with you through every moment and breath of this day. And when the eve comes and you lie down to slumber, guess what? He's still there. The Lord is with us. And I ask you, is he a source of joy? He was a source of joy for John. I mean, John couldn't contain it. He couldn't be quiet. He couldn't be still. He couldn't just lie there sleeping and enjoying the motion and the time. No, he had to celebrate because Jesus is here. And I think about that and I ask myself, it's Advent. We're 2 weeks in. Am I excited? Am I anticipating? Am I looking forward to that moment to go back once again through faith eyes and see Jesus lying right there in the manger? Is that filling me with such joy that I can't contain it? I've got to tell somebody. I've got to show somebody. I've got to share with somebody. Now, John couldn't keep it quiet. And Elizabeth, I'm sure tears were rolling down her cheeks as she announces, "This baby's going crazy." Because Jesus was there. Blessed is she who believed that the Lord will fulfill his promises to her. Blessed is he and she who believe that God will accomplish all he has said. Blessed. Friends, we're blessed. Because Jesus has come. Jesus has shown up. Jesus is with us. And I hope your heart is overflowing with joy. And we get to talk about joy in a week. But I hope it's overflowing. I hope you can't wait. Because you're excited. Because Jesus is here. And because Jesus is here. Because Jesus came in the manger. And then lived his life perfectly, fulfilling the last jot and tittle of the law so that he could go and be the sacrifice on the cross for our sin, for my sin, for your sin. You know what I'm joyful about? Is that I've got peace. I've got peace with God. And it's not something I had to go earn enough money to buy. It's not something I had to get good enough to deserve. It's not something I had to manufacture. It was a gift he gave through Jesus. And that joy yields peace. A peace that surpasses understanding. A peace that goes beyond description. A peace that never falters. It's always there. Even in a world of total chaos. We find peace. Friend, I pray you have found peace. I pray that this one we're celebrating in these weeks and coming Christmas Day is your Redeemer and your Savior and your King. That you understand who this child is. He's not just another Jewish baby. And even a Jewish baby boy, that's even greater for the Jewish people. But he is God, the Son. God, our Lord Jesus, our Savior, our Redeemer, our King. That's the child who's been born. It's the one who is with us. It's the one, he is the one who has come so that we will never, ever, 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 ever have to be alone. If we reject him, yes, you're alone, my friend. But if we receive him, we have that promise. Because God loved this world so much that he gave his one and only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. See, that's the message of Christmas. It is. I know we're going to have trees and lights and ornaments and gifts and maybe eggnog and punch and cookies and cake and feasts of all sorts. Those are all just extras, folk. Because it's the birthday of our King. It's the birthday of our Savior. It's the birthday of our Messiah. And I pray you are just brimming with joy because you have found that peace. Because you know who this child is. But if you haven't, if you've not surrendered your life to Christ, if you have not confessed your need for him, because you have to, he doesn't just show up in your life unless you invite him. He never, ever makes himself into your life forcefully. He comes because you say, Lord, please come. And he never fails to answer. If you have not asked Jesus in your heart, today is the opportunity. Today is the day of salvation, Paul says in Corinthians. Today, today. And we want you to make that decision today. So this season of Advent can be more than just precursor to Christmas celebration. But it'll be the moments of walking each day with joy, with peace, with love, with hope, and expectation and anticipation. Because you know what? Jesus is coming again. And we're going to see him. Are you ready? And brothers and sisters, are we so filled with joy we can't help but tell our family and our neighbors and our friends? And may I even say our enemies? Everybody needs to hear. Everybody needs to know. We need to declare who this child is because there's someone in the world who's asking what Christmas is all about. Who's asking, who is this Jesus? Who is this one you're celebrating? And guess what? We get to tell them. Will we embrace those opportunities? Will we declare who this child is? In just a moment, we're going to sing the song, What Child Is This? It's a wonderful carol. And as you sing those words, I pray they're not just words you do out of rote, but they're truly an expression of your heart to God today. And if you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, come today. We want to pray with you. We want to share with you. We want to pray and guide you so you can ask Jesus into your heart and that you will have him there and know him as we do. Brothers and sisters, if the world has pulled you every way, let him readjust. Let him recenter you to bring you back to his presence so you're fully surrendered to him. Our invitation's for all. Those of us who know him to get right afresh. Those who don't know him to come. And if the Lord's speaking to your heart about being a part of this fellowship, it's a time to come. Let God have his will. Let God have his way because we're celebrating this child. Emmanuel, our Lord and Savior, Jesus, our Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for these opportunities we have today. Opportunities to sing to you, opportunities to pray, opportunities to come and to share. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, may we be so overjoyed that just like John, we would leap. We would celebrate. We can't keep silent. And Lord, if there's any here or watching that have not made that decision to follow you, I pray they will turn and just cry out to you. Coming to know you is simple. It's hard because we've got to surrender all. But it's simple. We just need to ask. You tell us that you literally knock at the door of our lives, just waiting for us to open it. Not beating, not yelling, but simply knocking and asking to come in. If we've not made that choice, may we hear your voice again today. And may we respond. We give this time of invitation to you. Have your will and your way in each of our hearts and lives. May it be a time that further prepares us and positions us to engage this Advent season filled with your hope and filled with your peace. I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand as we sing.
What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him love, the babe, the Son of Mary. Why lies he in such mean estate, where rocks and ants are feeding? Good Christian, fear for sinners here, the silent word is pleading. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come pleasant King to own him, the King of Kings salvation brings. Let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary.
I pray that God blesses you in this coming week. I pray you look for those opportunities to share your joy and to tell about the peace you've found in Christ and the hope that's in him and the love you've experienced from our Heavenly Father. It is the season for us to get to share. May we be faithful. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time we get to share together today. And Lord, we thank you for your word and just for the example of John, even pre-birthal, jumping and leaping for joy because you were present. Lord, as you're present with us, may we jump and leap for joy. May we share freely. May we announce the good news. And in the season of Advent and Christmas, may we look for the opportunities to share with those you've brought into our lives. We love you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for the hope you bring us, the peace that surpasses understanding, the joy that is without end. Lord, fill us with hope and sharing it with the world that needs to hear. I ask in your precious and holy name. Amen. God bless you. Go in peace.